You're listening to the Hour of the Time. And before this broadcast is over, you'll probably wish that you weren't. I'm William Cooper. Make sure, folks, that you've got a notebook, a pen, an open mind. Make a space between your ears because I am going to implant some illumination. Don't go away. The Hermetic marriage, or the marriage of the sun and the moon, the origin of the Hermetic philosophy, will astound you. You're going to learn a few things about yourselves, about religion, and about Walt Disney tonight. Good old Walt. You've been leading your children to his lessons in the mysteries and the philosophic indoctrination into the philosophy of fire for many years, and you didn't even know it. Thoth Hermes, the ibis-headed, was the Egyptian god of wisdom, learning, literature, and science. Gnosis, if you will. The G in the center of the compass and square of the Masonic emblem does not stand for God or geometry. It means gnosis, knowledge, those who know. Thoth Hermes is accredited with being the first to reveal the art of writing to the present human race. According to the records available, he lived in Egypt as a contemporary of Moses. Some authorities even claim that Moses and Hermes were one and the same person. The Greek name Hermes is taken from an ancient root, herm, which means the active or positive, radiant principle of nature, sometimes translated as vitality or generative force, and known to ancient Freemasonry, or the Sons of Light, the Freemasons, as the cosmic fire. Hiram, and later as Hiram Abiff. Hermes Trismegistus, often called Mercurius Ter Maximus, dominated the philosophical and literary thought of the ancient world. His very name, ladies and gentlemen, became a synonym of wisdom. In fact, he was revered as the personification of philosophy and erudition. He was regarded as the first Kabbalist, the first physician, the first alchemist, and the first historian. The actual life of this demagogue and king of the ancient double empire of the Nile is obscured by that twilight which hides the origin of all peoples. And those who think they know, you can be assured, do not. By reason of his great wisdom and magical powers, Thoth was listed among the gods. Until today, many believe that he never existed at all outside of mythology. But if action and reaction are equal, then something more substantial than a mere legend must be the foundation for the towering superstructure of the Hermetic arts. During the early periods of human growth, when the intelligence of man was scarcely above that of the animal, according to the theory of evolution, all education was controlled by the priestcraft, just as I have outlined to you on many episodes of the Hour of the Time. The ancient priests were called the shepherds of men. The analogy is that men are sheep, are cattle. For the shepherds guarded the flocks of primitive human beings as the shepherd does his sheep. Are you beginning to have a flicker of understanding? Both science and philosophy were outgrowths of religion. In fact, all our present-day wisdom came originally into the world from between the pillars of the sanctuaries, the temples, what today you call cathedrals or churches. And it came from the priesthood, from the priests. Hermes was to ancient philosophy what Jesus is to Christianity, its light, its inspiration, and of course its impetus. The Egyptian initiates of the Temple of Isis claimed, therefore, that Hermes was actually the writer of all books on philosophical and religious subjects, that the supposed human authors were merely Amanuans who wrote down upon parchment or vellum the thoughts which this god impressed upon their consciousness, sort of like channeling. In scriptural terms, they were the pens, and he the ever-ready writer. During his lifetime, if indeed he lived, Hermes Trismegistus is supposed to have actually written 42 books. Some, however, are probably the work of the ancient Egyptian priests, for in their glory, these serpent-crowned hierophants represented the wisest group of philosophers that ever lived upon this planet. Clemens Alexandrinus states that these Hermetic books were divided into 6 parts, each dealing with a separate subject under such headings as astronomy and its inseparable companion, astrology, medicine, geography, the hymns to the gods, and of course other titles. During the ages that have passed, Hermes has come to be acknowledged as the godfather of science, particularly its chemical and medical branches. And even after the Christian era, numerous works dealing with religious and philosophical subjects were dedicated to him and to him alone. And the general term Hermetic art has been applied to practically all the abstruse sciences of the ancient, medieval, and modern worlds. The divine Pymander, more commonly known as the Shepherd of Men, and the Smaragdine tablet found in the Valley of Hebron are the most famous of the Hermetic fragments. You may reference this in a book by Manly P. Hall entitled The Lost Keys of Freemasonry. And these two works are probably authentic and contain many keys to the universal science of life as held by the mysteries, not necessarily me or anyone else, of which Hermes was a master. Nearly all Hermetic thought was an elaboration of the principle of analogy contained in the great Hermetic axiom, and you have heard me propound upon this before. And I quote, verbatim, "That which is above is like unto that which is below, and that which is below is like unto that which is above," end quote. Now at the present time, nearly all the so-called Hermetic writings are said to be lost. Only a few isolated remnants remain of what once must have been a magnificent collection of philosophical, medical, and religious wisdom. During the Middle Ages, one particular branch of Hermetic thought, alchemy, gradually came into prominence and for several hundred years dominated all other branches and was held under that ancient name, the Rosy Cross. For those of you not familiar with the subjects covered on this broadcast, alchemy was the androgynous parent of chemistry. Notice I said androgynous. This parent of chemistry, which was separated from its sire by the speculations of Roger Bacon and Bayle. While chemistry as a science dealt only with minerals, medicines, and essences, alchemy, ladies and gentlemen, struggled with the more profound elements of macrocosmic and microcosmic relationships and had absolutely nothing to do with what you have traditionally been taught. Alchemy undoubtedly originated in Egypt, for there, for there, the old legends go, the secrets of transmuting base metals into gold and of prolonging the life of the physical body indefinitely were thoroughly understood by the priestcraft, but this explanation was of the exoteric and not the esoteric meaning, which literally dealt with the soul and not the body, not the base metal. For it had nothing to do with metal. It was about elevating oneself above the animal, above the baseness of the human condition, to the purity of the consciousness of the soul, and thus a direct communication with God. Ancient records tell us that the Chaldean sages knew how to rebuild their bodies, many of them living to be over 1,000 years old, and then this again is a metaphor. Many of the processes by which this was accomplished were concealed under the sacred Egyptian rituals, such as the Book of Coming Forth by Day, which E.A. Wallace Budge has called the Book of the Dead. The correct title is the Book of Coming Forth by Day, not the Book of the Dead. In the Middle Ages, when religion divorcing philosophy was wed to blind faith, there was a renaissance of the alchemical and hermetic arts. They were revived by that type of mind which demands reason, logic, and philosophy, as well as hymns and prayers. Alchemy won numerous converts in Germany, France, and England. The long-ignored works of the Arabian magicians, or the Magi, enjoyed wide popularity, and from them was extracted the greater part of modern astrology. The ancient philosophies of the Jewish patriarchs were also revived, and Kabbalism became a universal topic of consideration. Paracelsus, the great Swiss physician, sometimes called the Second Hermes, undoubtedly rediscovered the ancient Egyptian formulae of the Philosopher's Stone and the Elixir of Life, and around him rallied a coterie of medieval philosophers who today stand out strongly against the dun-colored background of medieval culture. They are, in fact, some of the most interesting men of that period of history. Back of this revival of interest in ancient Egyptian philosophy, we may find the masterminds and guiding hands of three great philosophical movements who now control the world. One is known as the Order of the Illuminati, represented by Muhammad, Prophet of Islam. Roger Bacon, father of chemistry, and Paracelsus, father of modern medicine. Remember, the mysteries, or the religion of Illuminism, came from the Middle East, and thus properly belongs exactly where it is placed, represented by Muhammad, the Prophet of Islam. For it is from the Islamic faith that the Knights Templars brought the mysteries from the Middle East into Europe. It is an interesting fact that the present buildings and school of Rudolf Steiner, the German mystic, are located in the grounds of the old estate of Hohenheim, where Paracelsus lived. The Order of Freemasons, represented by the great Robert Flood, master of symbolism and alchemy, and Elias Ashmole, the unique philosopher, and the Rosicrucians, a sacred organization founded by the mysterious father CRC after his return from Arabia. You see, in the mythological city of Damkar, he had been educated in alchemy and astrology by Arabian adepts, according to the story. After him came Sir Francis Bacon, the remodeler of British law, and then Count Cagliostro, the sublime adventurer, and last and greatest of all, the great Comte de Saint-Germain, probably the world's greatest political reformer, an alchemist by fire and one of the greatest frauds that has ever lived. These superlative minds leavened the loaf of materiality, and according to those who study the mysteries, kept alight the flame of Hermes during the medieval centuries of religious intolerance and bigotry. Concealed beneath chemistry, the science of relating chemicals and elements, these minds discovered the ancient Egyptian arcana, long hidden by the crafty priests of Ra and Amun, and further concealed by that great mystery school known as the Vatican. Alchemy thereupon became the chemistry of the soul. For under the material symbol of chemistry was concealed the mystery of the coming forth by day. Now these ancient wise men taught that the world was a great laboratory, that living essences were the chemicals, that the span of life was a period of time given to the mind in which to experiment with the great agencies of nature, and that to the thoughtful came wisdom from their labors, while for the thoughtless life held only foolishness and sorrow. In this great laboratory, man learned how to combine the living chemicals of thought, action, and desire. And by learning the ways of nature, became the master of nature. According to those who believe, he became a god by actually becoming a man. You see, in the words of the great Paracelsus, and I quote, "The beginning of wisdom is the beginning of supernatural power," end quote. Of all the Hermetic mysteries, none is more perplexing than the so-called Hermetic marriage, a post-Christian interpretation of an ancient Egyptian ritual supposedly written 200 years earlier was published to the modern world in the first part of the 17th century under the name of the Chemical Nuptials of Christian Rosenkreutz. Little, if anything, has been discovered concerning the origin either of this book or the Fama Fraternitatis, which appeared about the same time. The exalted order of Rosicrucian philosophers, which today is known as the Rosy Cross, has been very reticent concerning its members and their works, and even today it is difficult to prove from a strictly material viewpoint that the order ever existed, unless, of course, you listen to the hour of the time, for we have proved it repeatedly, cited book, paragraph, chapter, and verse. Concealed under the quaint wording of the alchemical marriage can be plainly traced a series of mysterious formulae concerning the transmutation of base metals into gold, and I've already explained the esoteric meaning of that. The alchemist taught that man contained within himself all the elements of nature, both human and divine, and that by special culture, the base elements of his nature could be transmuted into the spiritual gold called the soul. In discussing this, Paracelsus makes plain that these philosophers did not wish to leave the impression that something could be made from nothing. Rather, they emphasized the fact that each individual thing contains all other things, and that the alchemical process of making gold was merely to culture the germ of gold, which is contained in every base substance, to bring it to the top, so to speak, above the baseness of human nature. Modern science substantiates the alchemical point of view by stating that it expects to extract gold from mercury by taking out or isolating the electron of gold, which is one of the constituents of every mercurial atom. Taking the chemistry of human relationships as a basis, therefore, we have prepared the following thesis concerning the true preparation of a philosopher's stone and the elixir of life, according to the fundamentals laid down by Hermes and the ancient Egyptian priestcraft. It is known as the Hermetic anatomy. A theory of natural creation has been generally accepted by the faiths of the world, with the possible exception of Christianity. You see, to the ancients, everything in nature was alive. Therefore, they accepted the human body as symbolic of the universe. The Hebrews called this prototype Adam Kadmon, or, in translation, the grand man, in whose mold all things were made. Every system of cosmogony, except the Christian, makes the universe a living thing. Instead of a God separated from his creation, the Brahmins, Jews, Persians, and Chinese have conceived their God as being completely involved in his creation. They have accepted more literally than the Christians the idea that man dwells in God, that in God he actually lives, moves, and has his being. They call this God Macroprosopus. Macroprosopus. Or translated, the spirit of the grand man, or, more commonly known to all of you, as the soul. From his body was made the macrocosm, consisting of suns, moons, planets, meteors, ethers, gases, and the sundry parts of creation. In the Scandinavian Eddas, the universe was formed from the body of Ymir, the Frost King. In India, the universe was constructed from the person of Brahma, whose members became the various bodies of the visible cosmos. The Hermetists therefore said, quote, man, know thyself, for thou, like God, art all wisdom and all power, and the shadow bearing witness unto the eternal, end quote. An anonymous alchemist writing in the Middle Ages stated, and I quote again, God has given man three ways whereby he may learn the infinite will. One, nature, for in the stars that twinkle in the sky, the planets in their thundering march, and the earth with its multitude of laws, are concealed the laws of God. Two, holy writ, the inspired word of saints and sages, unnumbered. And three, anatomy, the structure of our own bodies, wherein is concealed the structure of the universe, for all things are made by one mold. End quote. The electron, revolving around its nebular center, obeys the same law that moves planets around the sun. In this, we see the truth of the great Hermetic axiom, as above, so below, as with the lesser, so with the greater. This was believed by all of these ancient philosophers. The Hermetists spent much time studying the intricate construction of man, and like the Brahmins of India, they divided him into three major parts. In India, this trinity of basic parts is called Adi, Budhi, and Manas, meaning literally spirit, soul, and body. Their trimurti corresponds to the trinity of Christian theology. Each of these three major parts of a god, a man, or a universe was personified as an individual. The Adi, or spirit, was called the divine cause, or the father. Manas, or matter, was called the divine effect, being known in India as Shiva, and in Christendom as the Holy Spirit. Between these two stood Budhi, the mediator, the God-man, the Mercury of the Latins, the messenger of the gods. By some, this intermediary is considered synonymous with soul. By others, it is called mind, because mind is the uniting link between life in the sense of energy and death, in the sense of inertia. And to the pagans and Hermetists, all things in nature, the ethers, the air, minerals, even the earth itself, were endowed with intelligence, consciousness, and feeling. All was linked and gave rise to what you know today in what is known as the New Age movement as the Gaya principle. The Adi Budai Manas constitution of man, as represented by the alchemists under the symbolism of the philosopher's stone and its three important constituents, salt, sulfur, and mercury. According to alchemy, salt is the substance of all things. It is the body, the form, the dense crystallized particles from which all physical things are manufactured. Sulfur is symbolic of fire, the divine agent. Fire is defined by the Hermetists as the life of all things and is the adi of the Brahman Trimurti. Mercury, the universal solvent, becomes synonymous with Budai, the mind, the thing which absorbs all experience into itself, the link between God and nature. And now maybe you are beginning to understand how all of these esoteric thoughts, the religion of the mysteries, can be hidden behind symbology. Those of you who would read a book concerning the alchemist of the medieval times would have actually believed that they were attempting to create gold from lead. And you would have gained the exoteric interpretation concealing or reveiling the true exoteric meaning of the verse. And we're not through. Before this hour is out, you are going to be absolutely and totally amazed, for I have just begun. All the great world saviors have come, it seems, as personifications of Budai, as I have just explained its meaning, or the universal mediator. Like the Indian Vishnu, they have sought to bring God and man closer together, whether as Christ, Prometheus, Zoroaster, Krishna, or Buddha, they have come to bear witness to the Father, and being made in the semblance of man, but imbued with the Spirit of God, they have become personifications of the universal solvent, represented as mercury. To the Hermetists, man has always been considered androgynous, and they created the god Hermaphroditus to represent the duality of all living things. This word is coined from Hermes, fire or vitality, and Aphrodite, the goddess of water. The great Hermetic and alchemical adage was, quote, make the fire to burn in the water, and the water to feed the fire, and this lies great wisdom, end quote. It was the purpose of the pouring of the molten sea. It is the goal of the mysteries to reconcile fire and water, the conflict between God and Lucifer. Are you beginning to understand? There are deep meanings held in these metaphors. To the public was given one meaning, to the priesthood was given the truth. Don't go away. I'll be right back. Ladies and gentlemen, the hour of the time is brought to you by Swiss America Trading. They specialize in non-confiscatable, non-reportable hard assets of the type that you are, without any doubt, going to need in the very near future. For, at some point, probably closer than we think, this phony economy, backed by nothing, held up by nothing, must come tumbling down. And when that occurs, great suffering will take place in this country and around the world. And I, for one, do not wish to see this happen. However, I know that it will. And I know that those who are not prepared are certain to suffer beyond any concept of your belief. If you're smart, you will look around at the faces of your loved ones, and if you cannot assure them at this time, right this moment, that you have taken the necessary steps needed to make sure that their economic future is safe, then you must make this phone call. Whether you actually deal with our sponsor, Swift America Training, or not, is up to you. But you owe it to yourself to at least investigate the possibilities. And if you have some idea how you would like to place a portion of your assets in precious metals, make sure you reveal your thoughts to the good people at Swiss America Trading so that they can help you. Call now 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. And do it now, folks. You know how you are. 1-800-289-2646. You'll be glad. You'll be imminently happy that you did. Before the end of the hour, so make sure that you listen very, very carefully. The ancient Rosicrucians taught that the eternal feminine was not extracted from the nature of man, as Moses would have us think, but was rather made subservient to the opposite side of its own nature. They believed, you see, that every creature was essentially male and female. But for reasons which we will discuss later, only one phase of that nature manifested at a time. By fire, these philosophers taught that there was but one life force in the human body, and that man used it in the furtherance of all his labors, that he digested his food with essentially the same energy with which he thought, and reproduced his species with the same forces which he used in physical exercise. This force, personified, was said to be the builder of the universal temple. It became the Hiram Abiff of masonry, the builder of the eternal temple. In Egypt, this force is symbolized by a serpent, and it is worthy of note that in ancient Hebrew, the words serpent and savior are synonymous. And that should be a great revelation to many of you out there. Now remember, I'm not asking that you believe any of this. I'm merely revealing the esoteric meaning behind the stories that you have heard and read about in your education, in college, in your private life, in the movies, all your life. And yes, even in your churches. In ancient Hebrew, serpent and savior are synonymous. In the stanzas of Daizen, an ancient Tibetan fragment, it is stated that at one time a shower of serpents fell upon the earth. Now this is understood esoterically to represent the coming of the great world teachers who have long been called serpents, or the gift to man of intellect by Lucifer through his agent, Satan. You see, for at the basis of all of these esoteric mystery religions is the Luciferian philosophy. The savior of the Aztecs and Incas was called Quetzalcoatl, And this name means feathered serpent. From the serpent kings of Egypt to the feathered serpents of Tibet, the serpent is symbolic of the vital energies of the human body and is, in fact, a metaphor for the intellect, knowledge, gnosis. Moses raised the brazen serpent in the wilderness, and all who gazed upon it lived. Those who gained knowledge, who learned, survived. Those who did not, perished. Christ, whom they call the serpent reborn, says, quote, I, if I be lifted up, will draw all men unto me, end quote. The simile, folks, is obvious, yet few ever understand it. To the ancients, the magic wand was the spinal canal. Through this canal runs a sacred liquid, which they called in those days fire oil. Remember, these are the philosophers of fire. In Greek, Christos, the Savior, our Redeemer of things. And Christos are those who believed in this were called Christians long before the birth of Christ. In Greek, Christos, the Savior, our Redeemer of things. This same thought has been preserved for Freemasonry under the heading, quote, the marrow of the bone, end quote. The Hermetic philosophers recognized this essence in man as a distillation of universal life derived from the atmosphere, the sunlight, the rays of the stars, and food. This universal vitality, upon which all living things draw, is probably the origin of the myths of the gods who died for mankind. It is undoubtedly the origin of the legend of the Last Supper, for man eternally maintains himself upon the body and the blood of this spirit of universal energy, according to those who follow the mysteries. If this energy, which passes through the conduit of the spine, is drained off by various parts of the body, it stands to reason that waste will ultimately result in want. They knew, or thought they knew, that it was very undesirable to do heavy thinking directly after eating. Just as today they tell you, don't go swimming right after eating, for at such times the vital energies are digesting food and cannot safely be diverted to other channels. The admonition that you cannot go swimming directly after eating is a leftover legacy of this belief. By analogy, one-pointedness is the basis of success, for when the bodily energies are divided against each other, they cannot perform their proper functions. The ancients, you see, taught that the normal individual had two distinct avenues of expression, the first mental and spiritual, the second emotional and physical. The mental faculties were radiant, powerful, dominating, and strong, but often cruel and cynical. The mind was called the positive pole of the soul, while the heart was called the negative pole. And we have been taught that the spirit expresses itself through the mind, the soul and the body through the heart. The ancient alchemists called the mind the sun and the heart the moon, for to them strength, reason, and logic were masculine, paternal, solar powers, while love, beauty, intuition, and kindliness were feminine, maternal, lunar qualities, reflecting the pure light of their master. Just as the moon reflects the light of the sun, love, beauty, intuition, and kindliness reflect the dominance of the strength, reason, and logic. Now this will probably make clear why gold and silver had to be blended in the great alchemical enterprises, for the gold and silver of the alchemists were not dead metals, but living qualities in human life. The marriage of the sun and moon was therefore the marriage of the mind and heart, or the two halves of every nature. It was the union of strength with beauty, courage with inspiration, and in its greater sense, the union of science with theology, or God with nature. The urgency of this alliance is evident in the world today, where cold intellectualism and commercialism need the finer sentiments of friendliness and altruism to offset their heartlessness. On the other hand, fanaticism, blind faith, and ungoverned emotionalism require the strong hand of logic and reason to steer them away from the rocks of insanity and death. Perfect equilibrium in human nature is very, very seldom found. In fact, it is nature's greatest rarity. A person with that perfectly balanced viewpoint, however, is the living philosopher's stone. For he has the strength matched with kindliness and justice tempered with mercy. Hermetic anatomy teaches that there are two small bodies in the brain which are identified with the living yin and yang of China, or the positive and the negative, the male and the female. In the same way, every person has a masculine nature and a feminine nature, and never do we find these two entirely disassociated. It may be that East Indian philosophy gives us our best light on this rather perplexing subject, pun absolutely intended, for both the Hindus and the alchemists agree that the spirit, like God, is androgynous, being both father and mother. And, bear with me, it states in Genesis, quote, God created man in his own image, male and female created he them, end quote. So, while the creation is singular, within the creation there is two. Listen to it again, and listen very carefully. God created man in his own image, male and female created he them. We would infer from this that God is both male and female. And indeed, if male and female both came from God, then this must be true, as God is all things emanated from God and from nowhere else. And as the spirit of man is of God, it must partake of the androgynous nature of its parent. And in harmony with the Eastern sages, sex exists no more in spirit than it does in the embryo before the third month of prenatal life. Sex, you see, is a polarization of the body, a manifestation of spirit. The fetus, at one point in its development, can go either way, can be male or female. And all fetuses up to that point are exactly the same in their anatomy. But the germ of life itself is capable of projecting both the positive and the negative rays. So we now become involved in a still more perplexing problem, namely, what governs the sex which the animal being is to manifest during life? Well, many people will tell you many different things. The ancient philosophers would turn to the Eastern sages, and they would say evolution is the continuity of form appearing in cycles and gradually unfolding from a simple cell to a complex organism. If a form evolves, it is not absurd to suppose that the cause of that form is also evolving. The Oriental philosophy solves one of the Western world's greatest problems by the law of reincarnation, something which has never been proven to be a reality by anyone, and can be traced to its origin at a point in Indian history where the poor threatened rebellion over the wealthy rulers, and all of a sudden, this theory of reincarnation and karma cropped up to keep the poor lower classes in their place. And I haven't got time to go into that. This doctrine, which was removed from the Christian faith in AD 550 at the Council of Constantinople, taught that the spirit or life is immortal, that it descends into gross matter not once but many times in order that it may ultimately gain that perfection which no living creature has ever yet gained in one appearance in the world. They say, again, you must understand, none of this has ever been proven to be true. No one, on the other hand, can prove it to be false either. This doctrine also taught that the consciousness, thus descending into form, does not always appear in one sex, but alternates, first appearing in a masculine body, and then in a feminine, in this way developing both sides of the nature symmetrically. Now, if you accept this doctrine, it will go far toward solving a number of problems concerning heredity and the so-called injustice and inequality in the world. Even without it, Hermeticism can still stand with its aid. However, the alchemical philosophies become far more clarified, and of course, you have the option of rejecting it outright. The ancient wisdom teaches that the circle of the creative forces in the human body is broken at the present time. One end of this broken ring is in the brain, where it furnishes the power or vitality, which is the basis of brain function. The other end of this circle is located in the generative system, where it furnishes the means of reproducing the species. At a time remote in history, man was a complete creative unit in himself, they say, being capable of procreating his species like certain of the lower orders of animals of today. And if you believe in the theory of evolution, then this could be true. However, there is no proof of it whatsoever anywhere. There's no proof that the theory of evolution is correct, as a matter of fact. At that time, however, when these philosophies bore fruit, and at the time when man existed, they say, in this state, he had no mind. According to mythology, the raising of the brazen serpent therefore gave him a mind, remember the gift of intellect by Satan in the Garden of Eden, but broke the creative circuit. In the masculine sex, the positive pole of the life force is in the brain. The negative pole is used for generative purposes. In the feminine sex, the negative pole is in the brain. The positive pole is used for generative purposes. And again, this is the belief of those who follow the Hermetic philosophy. As a direct outgrowth of this condition, temporarily maintained in order that man may think and develop his higher nature and at the same time offer opportunity for other lives to come into manifestation, the institution of marriage was established. I bet you thought I'd never get there, didn't you? Marriage, folks, is therefore the Hermetic symbol of the ultimate reunion of the two halves of each individual's nature. When, after repeated appearances and associations, equilibrium between these masculine and feminine qualities is established. You see, the wedding ring was accordingly symbolic of the golden ring of the spirit fire, which connected the spiritual and material natures of every individual. And these beliefs and these marriages and this ring existed long before Christianity was ever the remotest thought in any human mind upon this earth. Ultimately, the present methods of reproduction will be abolished, they say, and both halves of the spirit fire will again be turned into the brain. One of them now finds its polarity in the pituitary body, and the other in the pineal gland. These two tiny ductless bodies, while an enigma to modern science, were recognized by the ancients as organs of great significance. The ancient wisdom teaches that the pineal gland was the original organ of vision, namely the third eye, called in the Sanskrit Dangama, or the eye of Shiva. It is the all-seeing eye of the Freemasons and the meaning of the word Buddha. And uniting its spark with the pituitary body, this gland fuses the broken circle and thus consummates the Hermetic marriage, whereby through an immaculate conception in the brain, the great light, the shining one, Lucifer, is born as a luminous spark in the third ventricle, which is the master mason's chamber in the ancient and accepted rite. Today, students of the ancient wisdom are seeking to prepare themselves for this peculiar work. The Hermetic marriage is, therefore, an individual matter, involving the attainment of individual completeness, requiring of the aspirant a sincere effort to be balanced, sane, and consistent in everything he does. In the alchemical retorts and vials, we recognize the bodies, glands, and organs of man, and in the chemicals, the essences and forces coursing through the body. With these, the individual consciousness must labor until it is capable of combining them according to the perfect formula. And now, Walt Disney. What child does not grow up in a fairyland extending from the first glimmer of understanding to the time when the grim realities of maturity tear down the dream world and replace it with hopelessness and despair. Hearts are broken all the way through this tragic pageantry of existence, the loss of innocence. But the first heartbreak is when the fairy stories and their wonderful little people are given up, and those beautiful beings with which we have peopled the world of our fancies give way to heartless human creatures in real existence. Man thoughtlessly destroys not only the dreams of others, but makes his own world a nightmare peopled with hobgoblins of selfishness and egotism. The fairies of childhood are always benevolent, kindly, helpful, serving the poor in distress, righting wrongs, and doing many beautiful things. While the realities of later life are generally malevolent and productive of all the miseries that the fairies of childhood sought to heal with silver-tipped wands and rainbow dreams. And there is a double meaning, as in the teachings of the mysteries and the fairy tales, there is an exoteric and an esoteric. Walt Disney, a 33rd degree Freemason of the Scottish Rite, a very famous Anglophile, a priest of the mystery religion of Babylon, has been teaching this esoteric meaning to your children throughout their life. In the great game of life, why can we not still preserve some of the beauty and romance of fairyland? This is what you see, the world of pixies, gnomes, and fairy godmothers in a Walt Disney movie is just as real in childhood as the grinding commercial system is during later life. You see, economics would suffer no injury, nor would standards collapse if dreams were perpetuated and man instructed how to build solid foundations under his castles of air. For human beings are ever children at heart. For you too, the parents, watch these movies and enjoy them. Man grows old, but he never grows up. Like Peter Pan, he is childlike from the cradle to the grave. Life for the average person has an insufficiency of beauty or sweetness with which to combat the sordid grind of modern things, and therefore these esoteric teachings can be presented to a receptive mind. And here and there, one lives a whole life in a fairyland of poetry, art, or music. It may be called a dreamer, but in the case of Disney, it is a message, an inculcation, a brainwashing, if you will. For will any child ever forget Cinderella and her wonderful glass slipper, how she met and won the beautiful prince while her envious sisters and cruel stepmother gnashed their teeth in rage? The story is part of childhood. But with the coming of years, poor little Cinderella is forgotten. The rag dolls are thrown in the corner. The toy blocks are covered with dust, for the dream world of childhood has faded from the mind, and little pattering feet, once running hither and thither, have given place to slow, uncertain steps. Yet the romance finds another setting. Prince Charming becomes a soda fountain clerk or a floor walker in a downtown store, while Princess Beautiful sells ribbons in some little country shop. The lives of people are really fairy stories, in which they play out the comedies and tragedies of their lives, seeking for something today to take the place of the shattered dreams of yesterday. And so they relish and absorb these movies, for they have a counterpart in nature. The world about us is filled with ugly stepmothers and half-sisters who cannot wear glass slippers. Do you remember Beauty and the Beast? How in spite of the sorcery that had turned the handsome prince into a hideous monster, the coming of beauty into his life restored him again to human form and happiness? Through the lack of beauty in his own heart, many an individual has become a horrible, hideous beast who, while still in human shape, has all the attributes of a ferocious animal. How often the sense of beauty is the thing that redeems. Beauty of soul and beauty of life bring back happiness to the beast. The whole world is a romance of Beauty and the Beast. We see it on the battlefield of Flanders, where flowers are springing up in the shadows of the trenches. In nature, we ever see beauty redeeming the beast. Out in the forest, the dark dead tree is gaunt and bare, but nature, with her magic wand, covers the tree with creeping vines, decking its gaunt limbs with mantles of flower. Have you read the story of Sleeping Beauty? If not, go straight to the library and visit the children's room. Sit down in one of those little chairs about 10 inches from the floor. get out the book with its colored pictures and much thumb pages and go with the prince through the great forest of nettles and thorns which surrounds the palace of Princess Beautiful. The princess is under a spell which causes her to sleep until she is awakened by the handsome prince who passes through all the obstacles in life in order to claim her as his own. The soul, the mating, the bringing together of the masculine and the feminine, after passing through the degrees, the trials, the tribulations of initiation in the mysteries. And I could go on and on and on and on and on, ladies and gentlemen, but unfortunately, we're out of time. Good night. God bless you all, and think of the magical lamp of Aladdin, the lamp of illumination.